there, friends. And that's right, we're back. Thanks again for joining us here on Expanded Perspectives. Like always, it's me, Cam. And like always, sitting across the desk from me today, pounding bottles of water, is the Philly, Kyle Philio Filson.
How's it going, everybody? I'm excited to be here.
Looks like you're trying to flush out the Zika you got at baseball practice. You
were talking about. Man, yeah, there was like a swarm of giant mosquitoes that, you know, came down upon me. I don't know if I have West Nile virus, Zika virus, something.
Westnil.
But they were all over me. Yeah, it was terrible. I'm like, note to self, bring mosquito repellent next time you have practice. Actually, it was pretty good until the sun went down, then we turned the lights on, you know?
And then here they come.
And man, they were coming in swarms. It wasn't as bad as it was when we were in Colorado bow hunting for antelope.
That was a horrible time.
That was the worst of it. I mean, I thought that was like a biblical plague. That's how bad those were. Remember that?
Yeah, we barely see any creatures whatsoever aside from giant mosquitoes. Folks, you in Colorado, y'all up there, I didn't realize the mosquitoes was that bad down there in the lowlands of that area until like when Kyle was talking about years ago when him and I went. That was crazy.
Without exaggeration, any piece of exposed skin would be inundated with mosquitoes.
Yeah, it looked like it was just like hair. They would just, man, it was wild. It was really, really wild. But speaking of really wild, Kyle, I know a lot of our listeners, some people have sent us these clips and these little links, and I've been keeping up with this stuff, and it's kind of funny. I know a lot of y'all have a problem with clowns. Don't really like creepy clowns, you know? And you know it's going to be coming up because of the remaking of It. I'm a big fan of Tim Curry and all that, of the original It. You know, I like all that kind of stuff. I'm a big fan of, what was his name from the Rob Zombie film? Captain Spaulding. That's one of my favorite clown guys right there. I may go as Captain Spaulding for Halloween this year. But anyhow, folks, this comes from AL.com, from our friends out there in Alabama. Roll Tide. It says here, creepy clowns put two South Alabama schools on lockdown, folks. Says several cryptic posts from the Facebook page of a group known as the Flomo Clowns put two Southern Alabama schools on lockdown. This is for a little bit of a while, they said, back this past Thursday. Says the Flomation Police Department received information from a parent that her child had been sent threatening messages on Facebook from the group. And after confirming the threat, the school in that area there, in the district there, of Flomation High School and Flomation Elementary School in Atmore, it says put them on lockdown. And it was lifted about lunchtime, about 11:30, 12 o'clock. But apparently the superintendent, John Knott, said that the parent of the student contacted the PD there about the incident. Says it's my understanding that it's the clown character who has been making waves across the United States. They determined the facts and immediately contacted the school. What they're talking about is like these people have reported seeing all these, you know, these strange clowns.
Yeah, from all over, right?
We posted it on Facebook. Yeah, people are kind of taking. This is one of those things that's never going to end well. Because what you're going to end up doing is, it's one thing to make people uneasy, a little bit of a joke, right? It's one of those things that's kind of like, ha, 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 it's funny, you know, you got just a creepy clown standing over there holding all black balloons, people drive by, and then it ends, it's been there about an hour, people get awkward, then you realize it's kind of dumb, and it goes on. People are going to keep pushing one another and pushing one another. Look, we're already on edge enough, you know, we need to, let's stop this silliness, let's start being, how about you stand around and hand out balloons? You know, why don't you do something nice instead of trying to get, it's always one of those people that always kind of gravitate, you know, towards picking at that scab, messing with people. You're going to find yourself shot. Seriously, you're going to mess around and you're going to do something foolish and somebody is going to smoke you. You don't want to think that way, but that's exactly what it's going to happen. But this is interesting. Apparently, the Flomo Clown posted, it's going down tonight on Facebook. And it had like the laughing face emojis and then the gun emojis. And then another one was posted after that that just says, I love kids. So it's caused a big problem, folks. If you look into any of this stuff, there's a little bit of things getting strange. Now, you can also go on YouTube. There's some videos you can go on and where the people are talking about it. And apparently there was a woman charged with a fake 911 call in that area in Alabama about creepy clowns. But so kind of keep your face, you know, your Facebook open. Keep your eyes open. Keep an eye out for the creepy clowns, because let's just knock this nonsense off. Let's move on. Have some fun. Like we said, hand out flowers, hand out hugs. Tell somebody they're doing something good.
Right.
You know, give out balloons. If you want to do something like that, smile, you know, and just stand around and wave and hold a sign telling everybody have a good day, you know, and be kind to your neighbors. Don't be a creepy clown. You're going to find yourself, you know, not holding fluid anymore.
Don't be a creepy clown. You're going to find yourself face down.
Yeah, well, there you go. The clean, yeah, right? That's exactly right.
Well, if clowns aren't scary enough, this is, according to President Barack Obama's chief science advisor, the world is still vulnerable, Cam, to a potentially catastrophic asteroid strike.
You're always talking about the asteroids. Enough.
It terrifies me. NASA has made substantial progress in finding the asteroids that pose the biggest threat to Earth. But there's still a lot of work to do, said John Holdren, who's the director of the White House's Office of Science and Technology. He said, "We are not fully prepared, but we are on a trajectory to get much more so." NASA, I don't know if you know this, Cam, is working on a new project called ARM, A-R-M, or Asteroid Redirect Mission.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
Pretty cool. Holdren cited that in February 2013... the meteor explosion over the Russian city of Chelyabinsk and also, of course, the world-famous 1908 Tunguska airburst are reasons to take asteroids much more seriously. Now, we've covered this on the show before, but he said if we're going to be capable as a civilization, we're going to have to increase our technology. We need to be prepared for these rare events because they could do a lot of damage to Earth. He says, like, the asteroid that came over Chelyabinsk seems to happen once every 100 years. The one like Tunguska happens once every 1,000 years. But we do know that this is a possibility. And this hazard, of course, the one that hit 65 million years ago, the one that destroyed the dinosaurs. He's like, we have to be smarter than the dinosaurs. We have to use the technology. And, you know, we've always complained on this show, instead of trying to do this or find some another planet Earth, and mm-hmm. let's worry about these asteroids. It seems like they're listening, and that's what they're starting to do. Now, ARM can help educate us. They say in late 2021, NASA aims to launch a robotic probe towards a near-Earth asteroid. The current target is a 1,300-feet or 400-meter rock called 2008 EV5. But they said that's not set in stone yet. They could always change by the time 2021 gets here. But that's their goal for right now. Now, after it arrives at the asteroid, the spacecraft will pluck a boulder off of its surface, then fly along with the space rock for a while, investigating the potential of a deflection strategy known as enhanced gravity tractor. Now, the standard gravity tractor method calls for nudging a potentially hazardous asteroid off course over the course of years or decades, using only a subtle gravitational tug of a tag-along robotic probe. This effect will be enhanced by the addition of the boulder's mass. Now, this probe will then head back towards Earth, eventually placing the boulder in orbit around the moon, and then astronauts aboard NASA's Orion space capsule will be able to visit the rock and be able to study it further, which will help us in learning how to get rid of these giant asteroids, if that makes sense. You know, a lot of it, the what they're made up of is not known 100%. You know, we only know about the ones that have, you know, landed here on Earth, and you can find mm-hmm. a piece of a meteorite and say, oh, it's made of this metal. But there's a lot of them out there that they're not 100% sure about. And by grabbing a piece of one, I guess, and studying it and practicing pushing them off course and stuff, this is gonna help us. They say the 1.25 billion ARM mission should help researchers learn more about asteroids and the resources and what steps we need to take to get rid of them. Now, if we detect one coming towards us, right, we know it's big and it's going to cause a problem if it gets here, we by studying these things, we'll have a few separate different plans on how to maneuver them. You know, of course, with the dead last idea, the idea of last result is, of course, atomic bombs trying to blow the things up. Mm-hmm. But they say that's only going to be used with space rocks that are discovered either too late to deflect them, you know, using these gravity tractors, or their kinetic impactors are too big. So they've developed this plan and they're putting it into motion, and hopefully within our lifetime, or at least our children's lifetime, we'll have enough skill by then to push these asteroids away from hitting the Earth. That's pretty impressive. Well, I just hope we have it. I hope they invent it in time before one comes, you know?
I hope that they get where they can find them faster, where they know that they're not just sneaking up on us as fast.
Well, you're right.
Because they come out of, like, blind spots where you can't see them hiding behind the sun and other stuff and come whipping through the dome over flat Earth and crashing into us.
Well, you're right about that. And I also thought about this when I was reading the article. Are they listening to the public and they're like, yeah, you know what? We do need to start working on this, deflecting the asteroid instead of exploring other realms or other universes.
Or
are they aware of something they're not telling us?
Are they getting, like, way closer than we think?
We better start working on this because this thing's coming. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The conspiracy person in me starts to waken up. Anyways, pretty cool.
Well, instead of us bouncing from Alabama, we're going to go up there to the land of Habo. We're going to go to Arkansas, folks. Get your pens out. Get your paper out. We're going to jump into case 79100. This comes from openminds.tv, folks, with the MUFON case that, like we said, we always talk about the strange reports of different shapes, but this is a traditional triangle-shaped UFO. It states that an Arkansas witness saw one at treetop. But this is the part that I like the most. It says an Arkansas witness at Bella Vista and his wife rushed to a bedroom window after hearing, now this is what they said, folks, jet-like sounds, and then watched a triangle-shaped object just 100 feet over the rooftop. All right?
Yeah.
Now, it says that the witness was lying in bed on September 11th this year about 10 p.m. when they first heard the incident. It said, I heard what sounded like an airplane about to crash or flying super low. We rushed to the bedroom window and saw a huge triangle-shaped aircraft flying about 100 feet above the house. The witness goes on to say that he and his wife, of course, got up and moved outside. It says, we watched it fly slowly and still very low. It seemed to have vanished in the tree line, but then came back out like it was looking for something. They state that we saw red, blue, and white lights on a huge black triangle-shaped craft.
At least it's patriotic.
Exactly, right? September 11th, we stood in the driveway and watched it as it left our sight. Every animal in the neighborhood was going crazy, and just like that, it was gone. Now, MUFON, it says, reports that indicated the witness was less than 500 feet from the object, and that it was moving along at treetop level. And like we said, of course, this was back in September 11th this year. So just a few weeks ago, this happened. So, look, the part that I like the most, of course, is always the triangle-shaped stuff. But it goes back into the idea that this is something that's ours. They heard this one fly by.
It sounded like a jet.
Yeah.
Probably
maybe,
was, right?
Well, maybe it came out of cloaking. You know, you popped out of cloaking. It's like, you can't run silent now. We're going to have to do something else. And then it comes back out and does its thing.
Have you ever seen one of those, like, Hawker Harriers, the ones, the jets that hover and stuff? Have you ever heard how incredibly loud those things are?
Well, the first time I ever heard it, you and I were, like, 14 at the air show in Fort Worth.
Oh, you were with me?
Yeah, and it was just roaring, and I was like, good God. It had, like, a whine, like a high, like a real high pitch, like, in the exhaust. You could hear a whistle. I'm like, you're not going to sneak up on nobody in that thing.
Well, and that was 1980s technology. Yeah. So you can imagine now if they created this triangle-shaped jet of some kind, that it's probably, although still makes noise because it was detectable by not only them, but all the pets and animals in the neighborhood, couldn't that be just some top secret machine of some type? Does it have to always be extraterrestrial?
This is my ore. Like, you had an ore. This is my ore for this. Because when I read this, this is what I was thinking. What they heard was the engine of this craft. Or what they heard was the engine of the jets that were either escorting this craft or were scrambled to find this and intercept this craft.
Very true. I wasn't there.
Exactly.
You know, it's that's what we always talk about in the show. Or any show that talks about people's sightings. I can't ever say without certainty what these people witnessed. Unless I was standing there, I do not know.
Well, and it's like we always bring up. It's always so odd that they have a red and, or, you know, not just red, white, and blue, but they have lights on them.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I did not know there was an intergalactic code for safety and landing lights, like with a boat, with like a blue and a green.
Well, maybe there is.
I didn't know all this stuff.
Maybe they know that we put lights on our stuff, so they're putting lights on their stuff so that they try to blend in.
Yeah, maybe so. Who knows?
You know? Well, if that isn't scary enough, or asteroids or clowns didn't scare you, this should. Ancient megavirus that does not resemble any virus on Earth is set to be revived.
Oh, boy.
Now, invoking visions of mad scientists, French researchers are set to revive a megavirus dormant for over 30,000 years that they recently discovered in the permafrost of the Russian Arctic. Now, researchers from the French National Center for Scientific Research say they will take precautions to revive this specimen under safe laboratory conditions. They published a paper detailing the research in the Journal of the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. Now, Cam, I know you're a subscriber to that.
Of course.
Periodical. The group of researchers is headed by a man named Jean-Michel Clavier, who runs a laboratory at the French Center. Now, American scientists revived the Spanish flu virus back in 2004 to try to understand its extreme virulence. That virus killed tens of millions of people. Now, the researchers went to Alaska and took samples of lung tissue from a woman who had been buried in the permafrost. Using those samples and autopsy tissues, these U.S. scientists pieced together the code for the eight genes. The scientists did the work at the ABC Net Calls, a top security laboratory of the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention in Atlanta, Georgia. Now, these French scientists who awakened another Siberian virus known as Pithovirus sibiricum in a petri dish in a lab back in 2013 warned that climate change, Cam, may awaken dangerous viruses in areas of the far north where soil or permafrost is melting, and believe that it's better to know the enemy. That's the reason they're doing this. So, you know, naturally when people are like, well, why are they trying to reawaken these viruses? They're doing it as a preemptive step to save us, perhaps, if these things come online, say, in, you know, Mother Nature terms, come online. And if we're not prepared, bingo, we're in trouble. So they're doing it on purpose. They've revived, they say, four prehistoric viruses since 2003. And so they're working on it. But what's crazy is that these viruses don't resemble any virus known on Earth that exists today. Modern viruses, they say, are tiny and have only a few genes. But this Pithovirus sibiricum and Molyvirus sibiricum contain 500 genes, placing it in a new category. They say that most genes, even big ones like HIV virus, I can't talk, HIV virus has 12 genes in it, and influenza has 8 genes in it. One of these cryptoviruses that they found, this pandavirus, has over 2,500 genes. So these are much larger and much bigger than anything that's existing now. Now, you may ask yourself, you know, what kind of precautions are they taking so that this thing doesn't cause a deadly zombie outbreak? They say that they have a whole list of procedures and protocol that they have to adhere to, and they assure everybody that it's in a safe and contained area, and there's virtually no way for it to be spread to the humans, to the human race, as of, you know, as long as they're doing it at this disease control center, that they are masters of this. Well, you know, that's
unless, alleged.
Right, and so unless some terrorist comes in there and sneaks that, you know what I mean? You
can think.
But so this is more of like a headline grab where they put this doom porn out there that these scientists are reanimating these deadly viruses. They are. But when you understand the reason for them doing it, it's to help us in case something bad happens in the future. We've got to be prepared.
You know what gets more people killed? Complacency. Thinking you're really good at something when you're really not as good as you think.
Oh, that happens all the time.
That goes back into, oh, yeah, it won't get loose. It won't get loose. Next thing you know, we're all in The Walking Dead.
That's right. Well, you know, malaria, it kills more than any other disease.
Yeah, yeah.
It's insane how many. What is it? I heard on one other show, it might have been Joe Rogan's
show. Half of everyone who has ever died in the history of this planet, they know has died from malaria.
That's incredible.
That's an insane number. If that's a real number, that's a completely insane number.
That's pretty scary. Well, also speaking of scary, what we're going to be talking about on today's show is something unique. It's about man-hunting serial killers of the animal world. Stick with us, folks. You're listening to Expanded Perspectives. Of all the people on this earth, perhaps none is more terrifying than a ruthless killer. We're not talking about someone who kills out of anger, or kills out of jealousy, or revenge, no. We're talking about a person who kills for fun or delight, a serial killer. But they are not alone. We have more than just the bloodthirsty killers of our own kind to worry about. The animal kingdom, too, on occasion, rises against us, and it seems like Mother Nature herself sends one of her emissaries of death to take care of us feeble and weak humans. I'm talking about wild animals that not only kill humans, but seem to enjoy it. Some of these serial killers of the natural world have gone far beyond merely turning to mindless man-eating. They stalk the dark jungles of the world, methodically hunting down their human prey, only to lie in wait to do it again. They seem to display a certain demonic intelligence, an uncanny ability to evade capture, or to disappear into the shadows that seem to transcend simple animal instincts. Whether it's out of insanity, revenge, or something else darker and more sinister, these animals seem to kill not out of any real need to feed, but rather seem to be driven by some dark, wicked intent. In some cases, these ruthless killers are often so cunning and elusive that they evolve into something more than a mere animal, becoming ghosts, spirits, or gods, and moving from the animal kingdom into dark folklore and myth. Perhaps the most notorious killers among the cases of animal serial killers are the Tsavo man-eaters, also referred to as the ghost in the darkness. Now, most of you listening to this know about them, but if not, they were a pair of male lions that worked in tandem to embark on a terrifying killing spree back in 1898 that claimed the lives of at least 35 people, and by some estimates, more than 135. The incident occurred in Kenya, Africa, on the Tsavo River, where construction had begun on a bridge for a railway in March 1898. The project was undertaken by the British and led by Lieutenant Colonel John Henry Patterson. In addition to British personnel, a great many African and Indian workers were employed to work on the ambitious project. This was a scorching land of dry, unforgiving savanna, full of 3-meter-high grass, and known to the natives rather grimly as the worst place on earth. The rugged terrain of Tsavo was a challenging locale to work in at the best of times, yet the construction crew was to have more to worry about than just the harsh conditions. Soon after work began on the bridge, workers began to be picked off by a pair of maneless Tsavo lions. Often, the unfortunate victims were dragged screaming and kicking from their tents into the darkness of night, where they were brutally killed and eaten. These lions were incredibly bold. They weren't like normal lions, no. They were different, as if possessed by something dark, terrible. They were not scared or intimidated by humans at all. They seemed to enjoy their work and took some kind of pleasure killing humans for sport. They grew so bold, they would even attack in broad daylight, on occasion snatching hapless workers away in full view of horrified onlookers. These grisly attacks continued for months, and the terrified, demoralized workers took measures against the rampaging lions. They first tried using campfires to try and scare the animals off, yet this had little effect against the fearless killer cats. Thorn fences, called bomas, were also erected around camps in an effort to stop the relentless attacks. But the lions, somehow, managed to crawl through the barricades and continue their carnage. All efforts were unsuccessful and did nothing to staunch the bloodshed caused by the marauding beasts. Patterson, a well-known and skilled marksman, took it upon himself to try to stop these lions. He first set up some traps, but the lions displayed an eerie and uncanny ability to avoid them. When the traps failed, Patterson took to using a hunting contraption of Indian origin, known as a macan, which was basically a seated platform held over the ground on tall stilts. For several nights, Patterson waited, perched in his flimsy hunting seat, up in the air, waiting for the man-eaters to appear, to no avail. The two lions evaded the setup and even attacked the camp on several occasions while Patterson sat there, waiting to kill them. Whispers around the camps began to speak of the lions not as animals, but as vengeful spirits from the netherworld, reincarnated as bloodthirsty lions to haunt the living. And they named the two spectral lions the Ghost and the Darkness. Some workers were afraid to work or to leave their camps at any hour, lest they fall victim themselves to these angry spirits. The British tried to reassure the workers by telling them there was nothing paranormal about these lions and that these lions were probably just injured or starving and simply relied on each other to hunt for food. It was thought that if one of them were to be killed, then the other would soon perish as well. Patterson, having little luck, decided to expand his search. Since the camps were spread out for miles along the Tsavo River, it was difficult to predict where the lions would strike next, and Patterson believed that they were cunningly avoiding him. During his search of the wilderness, Patterson would come across what appeared to be the lion's grisly lair, a stinking, dank cave with the rotting remains of dozens of mangled victims strewn about. He couldn't believe what he was seeing. There were bones everywhere. Hundreds of human bones were strewn all around. It was clear that these two lions had been killing people in the area for a long time. Although some of the bodies had been devoured, others had merely been mauled and dumped in the filthy cave, leading Patterson to the chilling conclusion that the lions were not only killing for food, but for the sheer thrill of it. The hunter scoured the wilderness in his tireless search for the lions, never getting a clear shot, yet often hearing panting and low growls in the darkness, just out of his periphery of his vision. The lions would pass quite close to the camp, rumbling threateningly, almost as if to taunt him. Sometimes, the eyes of the lions could be glimpsed, flickering in the darkness from the reflected firelight. It became more apparent to the disconcerted hunter with each passing day that the roles had been reversed, and that it was in fact the lions who were doing the stalking. As the situation grew more intense, Patterson came to the sobering realization that rather than the lions avoiding him, in fact, he had become the hunted. After several unsuccessful attempts to kill the beasts, Patterson was able to shoot and kill one on December 9th, 1898, approximately 9 months after the start of the bloody attacks. 20 days later, the second lion was killed. Patterson explained in harrowing detail how it had taken 9 shots to bring the second animal down, and that it had died gnawing on a tree, still trying, even in its last moments, to savagely come at him. The first of the Tsavo man-eaters, the larger of the two, measured 9 feet, 8 inches, or 3 meters from nose tip to tail. It was so heavy that it took 8 men to carry the carcass back to camp. Construction of the bridge was subsequently completed in February 1899. The remains of the two lions were sold to the Chicago Field Museum in 1924, where they were mounted and preserved and remain on display to this day. But these two killers are not alone. They are not standalone cases. Oh no, there are others. There are others in the feline community. In the early 20th century, the central provinces of India were terrorized by a man-eating leopard that is thought to have killed over 150 people and earned itself the nickname of Devilishly Cunning Panther. The leopard was extremely aggressive and a prolific killer, reportedly killing a victim every 2 or 3 days. It was difficult to predict when the killer would attack, and it seemed to roam over a wide area, never attacking in the same place twice, and making kills 20 to even 30 miles apart. The rising body count and unpredictability of the attacks sent villagers throughout the region into a panic. Many men refused to go to work or even leave their homes. A British PH, or professional hunter, was brought in and tasked with finding the beast, but it would prove to be a challenging feat, even for a professional. The hunter searched the terrain for 3 weeks without any success, whereupon a boy came to him, claiming that his brother had been brutally killed by the big cat as they were driving cattle. The hunter set up an ambush for the leopard near the victim's corpse, but when the cat came that evening, it would not emerge from the underbrush for a clear shot. The frustrated hunter attempted to spook the cat into the open by shouting and firing his weapon into the air, but his quarry was not intimidated at all and simply sauntered off into the night. Once again, almost like out of a movie, the hunter soon realized, just like with Patterson, that the roles had been reversed and the big cat was now actually stalking him. This became further apparent when he awoke upon spending the night in the tree to find that the cat had appeared out of the jungle as he slept and was now clawing at the trunk. In another incident, the hunter awoke in his tent to find the leopard looming outside and clawing at the fabric menacingly. In this case, the shouts of villagers scared the animal back into the forest. The leopard continued to prowl the countryside, killing both humans and livestock at an impressive rate until it was finally brought down by a gas-propelled shell from a pipe at close range. What makes this case peculiar is that while most man-eaters have turned to eating human beings due to injuries or old age, preventing them from hunting their normal prey, the leopard of the central provinces was found to be in excellent health, with perfectly normal and formidable claws and teeth. This suggests that rather than eating humans out of necessity, the leopard had simply enjoyed human flesh, perhaps even relishing in the killings of humans. Some experts have suggested rather chillingly that the cat might have been fed human flesh as a cub. Its mother might have been a man-eater as well. Man-eating killer wildlife is not limited to only large cats. There are others that lurk in the water, which is a very good reason why Cam avoids water at all costs. One animal that seems to have particular skill when it comes to killing humans is the Nile crocodile. The Nile crocodile is an African crocodile and may be considered the largest extant reptile in the world after the saltwater crocodile. They usually grow to a length around 12 to 14 feet or 3.6 to 4.3 meters and they can weigh from 500 to 1200 pounds or 227 to 545 kilograms and have a lifespan of 70 to 100 years. There is an enormous Nile crocodile that lives in the Rusizi River and the northern shores of Lake Tanganyika in Burundi, Africa, named Gustave. He is an absolutely huge specimen for his species, estimated to be up to 25 feet or 7.5 meters or more in length and weighing well over a ton. They believe that he is the largest Nile crocodile ever recorded. One estimate of Gustave's age was around 60 years old, which makes it possible that he is still growing. It also means that the crocodile has survived countless threats over the years, from civil war to heavy crocodile hunting for sport and bounties during the 1940s, 50s, and 60s. The trial of Gustave's tumultuous past are reflected in his badly scarred body and eye, thought to be the result of a bullet wound sustained under unknown circumstances. Other than his tenacity and uncommonly large size, Gustave is most notorious for being a prolific man-eater, snatching people with astounding speed and ferocity from the banks of the river and lakeshore. Gustave's bloodlust is legendary. He is said to be the culprit behind over 300 killings and has obtained a mythical status in the lore in the area. The crocodile is known for killing sprees lasting several days, during which he will kill up to a dozen people before disappearing for a while, only to resurface somewhere else and kill again. It is claimed that Gustave often kills for the fun of it, leaving the carcasses uneaten, a claim further bolstered by the fact that crocodiles can go without food for several months and have no need to kill so prolifically. The crocodile has been known to creep up on fishermen and pull them under the water until they drown, only to simply swim off afterward, leaving the body untouched. He is such a bold and remorseless killer that there have even been reports of Gustave actually killing off whole groups of five or six people at one time, only to leave the corpses where they lie and slip away into the murky, blood-stained river. Gustave is highly feared by locals, with some saying that he's some sort of supernatural creature rather than a normal crocodile. Gustave has eluded repeated attempts to capture him over the years. Numerous traps and snares baited with everything from goats to chickens to even a live dog have so far failed to capture the beast. The last verified sighting of the murderous crocodile was in 2008, leaving his fate unknown. However, locals have claimed that he's in fine health and is still out there, prowling the waterways, bidding his time to strike again.
Thank you.
Moving on. Everyone now realizes how terrible zoos and aquariums can be for certain animals. Most notably, for predators. Being kept and caged as a predator goes against everything they were created for, probably turning some of them insane. I think that is the case for this next story. Tilikum is a 6.9 meter or 22.5 foot, 5,400 kilogram or 12,000 pound bull orca or killer whale, who currently resides at SeaWorld Orlando, Florida. His captivity started at 2 years of age when he was captured off the coast of Iceland in 1983. The orca is most well known for being involved in the killing of three people over the years. The first killing occurred in 1991 at Sea Land of the Pacific in British Columbia, where Tilikum was originally kept. 20-year-old marine biology student Kelty Byrne was working part-time at the park as a trainer and jumped into the tank during a show where Tilikum and two other orcas were kept. Without warning, the three orcas converged upon the hapless trainer, pushed her underwater, and dragged her around the tank in full view of horrified spectators. Byrne, a competitive swimmer, was nevertheless unable to get to the surface as the orcas repeatedly prevented her from doing so. They also actively kept her from grabbing life rings that were thrown to her by the other trainers. At one point, the terrified, screaming Byrne finally managed to reach the side of the pool, but was dragged back into the water as she tried to climb out. The flailing trainer thrashed about in the water as the orcas tormented her, and she eventually drowned. The orcas initially kept anyone from retrieving the body, which was not removed from the pool until several hours later. After this gruesome incident, Tilikum was moved to SeaWorld Orlando. It was here that the orca struck again. On July 6, 1999, the dead body of a 27-year-old Daniel P. Dukes was found draped over Tilikum's back. The man was naked, his swim trunks apparently torn from his body by the orca, and his body was covered in numerous contusions and lacerations. It was later discovered that the man was a visitor who had snuck into the park at night after closing time and had entered the orca tank. It is unknown what compelled the man to do this, although an autopsy found no evidence of drugs or alcohol. On February 24, 2010, Tilikum killed for the third time. Veteran trainer Don Branshaw was massaging Tilikum after a show when the whale suddenly and violently pulled her into the water in front of dozens of stunned onlookers. Witnesses say that the orca dragged her by the arm, ignoring all attempts to entice him into letting the trainer go. Desperate employees resorted to coaxing Tilikum into a smaller medical pool where it was thought the orca could be controlled more easily. Tilikum finally released Branshaw's body, but it was too late. The trainer had suffered extreme blunt force trauma from the wrath of the orca, including a severed spine and numerous fractures. In addition, her scalp and left arm had been practically torn apart from her body. Although the park was fined for safety violations directly related to Branshaw's death, Tilikum returned to performing in 2011. It is not known for sure what exactly prompted Tilikum to kill three people, or whether he will eventually kill again. These are just a few cases of animals who not only kill, but seem to get some sort of entertainment from it. Are these just examples of mental health issues among a few large predators? Or is there something more? Has some horrible person, some killer from a previous life, somehow been reincarnated into an animal form only to continue their terrible ways? Or perhaps Mother Nature herself is striking out and taking revenge on humans for the terrible ways we treat our planet, stripping and raping the land and oceans of all its beauty and bounty. The next time you're in the woods or water, be leery Who knows? One of nature's killers may be laying in wait. And we're back with Expanded Perspectives. It's an interesting topic. I've never really heard discussed on another show. You know, so many people talk about just serial killers, but they never really contemplate when animals somehow, some way, seem to become serial killers. Like, they have this bloodlust or this great disdain towards mankind. And in some situations, like the one about Tillamook, like I was saying, anytime you you can put certain animals in a zoo and they're fine. And these are like animals that are used to getting eaten by other animals, like, say, a giraffe, for instance. A giraffe doesn't have any problem being held in captivity in a zoo. It's like, sweet, here I am, I get food every day, and nothing can kill me.
Yeah, I'm safe.
But if you're a predator, like a killer whale, an orca, or a lion, or a jaguar. Something that hunts. You put that thing in the same cage, and it's, I mean, you might as well kill it. It's worse than killing it. You know what I mean? Its sole purpose on this planet is designed for hunting, and you're taking that away from it. It's a sad sack. And I don't know if you've seen it. I think most people probably have now. Blackfish, the documentary about the orcas and stuff. After you see that and you kind of realize it and you watch how the mother orcas are crying as they're stealing the babies and stuff, you're like, man, that is messed up. I'm not supporting this. I'm no longer going to go to SeaWorld. This is jacked up. And zoos, I thought about it a lot. Of course, little Luke, he likes to go to the zoo, but he's four. Zoos at one time, I understood what they were used for. In like the 1920s, say, there was no internet. There was no books with pictures of an elephant. So if you wanted to see this animal or whatever it was, you just heard stories and you would actually have to go to a zoo to see it. But nowadays, look at Luke and his iPad. Does he ever really need to go someplace to see a baboon that's been captured? You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know exactly what you mean.
I think that they served a purpose for a time. I don't think that they're needed anymore. I don't think we should do away with all zoos. And now, of course, aquariums where it's just like, you know, clownfish and stuff. No, there's nothing wrong with that. But these aquariums where they have like these shows with porpoises and orcas and things, I think that that's terrible and that they should make all of those legal.
I'm not a fan so much of zoos, of pretty much any, like you're talking about. There is a line, you know, always people, you get the people that are always like, well, where do you draw the line on what animals do you eat? You know, you need to be a vegan, you need to be this and that. We can get down into splitting hairs and really getting down in there. But overall, I'm not a fan of circuses. I'm not a fan of zoos. I'm not a fan of anything. I'm not saying that, you know, that animals' rights outweigh the rights of human beings. But what I am saying is it's not needed. Some of this stuff is no longer needed. I understand the antiquated way of thinking when it was something, but it's not needed. But going back to the original thing is this. So many times that we grow accustomed to it not happening to us. You know, we don't have a lot of animal attacks in North America. It just doesn't happen. Whereas when other countries like Africa is the prime example, it is a way of life. This is things that happen on the reg in those areas. So can't really relate to those ideas. So you get into, I'll tell you how it got me going with this whole thing before I go into that. But what I'm thinking about is it's one thing when animals eat because they're either injured or they're starving, or it's just because they're there and it's easier to, for them to catch us because we are pretty much just weaklings when it comes to defending ourselves against the animal. But it's another thing when the animal kills and then does not consume. It's just like that. It is a serial killing animal. They just kill for the hell of it. Just kill you and leave. Kill you and it's like it's no big deal.
Yeah, it's not.
What got me into this whole thing was back when I was in high school, even, is when it started, is I'd come across a book called Death in the Long Grass.
Yep, I've read it.
Written by Peter Hathaway Capstake. I own all of his books. And there's one that he wrote that's my favorite one that he wrote is called Death in the Silent Places. Long Grass is great. Silent Places mm-hmm. is better. They talk about a jaguar fighter. They also, but he wrote a book in 81 called Maneater. And if you really want to get into it, you can read some stuff about that when it talks about his adventures along those lines of, because he was a writer. He was a graduate there in New York, or in New Jersey, I believe is where he was actually born.
Yeah, he's from New Jersey. Yes, sir. Yeah,
he graduated from the University of Virginia is where he actually graduated from. But I believe he was an accountant. And when he couldn't deal with the accountant anymore, he went and actually became a professional hunter. He guided hunters in Africa. And this is, of course, back in the day whenever it was way more romanticized and a lot wilder than it is, of course, today. You know, it's not quite like it is. If you're interested in reading some strange tales of stuff like that, of him actually personally dealing with these animals, and he's an excellent writer also, but you can get into that stuff. I believe he passed away in 1996 when he passed, but he wrote a ton of books on it. And it was, that's where I guess I got the fascination with. That's when I very first heard about the Lions of Tsavo, when he talked about that, you know, and you start getting into these tales of people that deal with it, these attacks on people all the time. And it gets to that point to where some of these animals do seem to take on a human trait of hatred, a human trait of, because it's so easy to kill us that they're just like, it's almost a game. How many times have people witnesses that are cat owners? You have a cat at home. How many times have you seen it playing with either a bug or a mouse or a frog or a lizard or anything that it catches? It's just toying with it. It knows it can dispatch it whenever it wants. Well, that's the way these large cats seem to be doing with the human beings, is it almost seems like they're just playing with us. And there's nothing shows it any more than the gorilla that was killed in Cincinnati.
Yeah.
You know, I believe it's Cincinnati is where, what was the gorilla? Harambee or whatever. There's nothing shows it any more than that, when how easy he was moving that child around. You don't realize how much stronger they are than us. So you see all this, and it's one of those things that we don't ever discuss because it doesn't happen to us, but it's still a slightly terrifying thing. Look at the number of mountain lion attacks in California. Mm-hmm. They've just escalated. Look, you know, there's so many things can go wrong so fast with these animals, but we look at them as Disney creatures. So I really enjoy stories like this because it's good for people to know, hey, look, I mean, there's a video online, you know, that you can go watch people jumping over the fences in Yellowstone to go up and take pictures of buffalo. And they're like, dude, don't get in there. Don't get near them. Or you're driving out and you want to get out of your car and run up and go mess around with some bull elk. You're like, it has weapons on its face. You know, that's what it's going to do to you.
Yeah, or the feeding of bears and things like
that.
You know, and then there's the tragedies of, well, people over here will be like, oh no, there's all the tigers are being killed out of this region, or the dentist who shot Cecil the lion. Remember mm-hmm. how terrible it mm-hmm. is? But I always want to know, is that the thoughts of the people that live there? Because I bet you those people are like, thank God that murderous lion has been dispatched. I don't want it to steal my baby.
Yes.
You know what I mean? You just don't think about it because you live in the Western world, like you're saying. We live in modern cities and stuff. We don't have the fear of that.
Yes. But we can't relate to it. There's no way we can relate to it.
There are people right now living in spots where they just live like in a tent or like just a rickshaw. You know, it's like a small mm-hmm. shanty building. And something can come bursting through there and literally kill them. And if that even happens, how much of that is even reported? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
There could probably be several people every day dispatched. And we're just not even aware of it. Just like these hunters that go missing in the woods. I mean, what happens?
Yeah.
Maybe something got them and ate them.
Yeah, exactly. Well, and that goes back into the whole missing 411 of maybe
it's true.
Maybe Bigfoot's killing people and eating them. I mean, we don't really know what's getting to them. We know there's animal attacks.
Right. But I like these stories that we talked about today because they're specifically pointing out animals that don't just do it a few times, but seem hell-bent on doing it.
Yes.
Over and over.
It's personal
and over.
With them.
Yeah, very... very scary.
I've got you something here, Kyle, before we wrap this puppy up, folks. For any of y'all out there that are annoyed with the fact that I buy a bottle of ketchup and I can't get all the ketchup out of the bottle. Okay. I buy a bottle of syrup. I buy a bottle of honey and I don't get it all. It's stuck to the inside of the bottle. For those people, fear not, my friends. Fear not. There is a company called Liquiglide, and they signed a deal to license this technology that they come up to with a European company that makes mayonnaise. What it is a super hydrophobic coating. That's right, folks. It's a water repellent, and they're using it in our food. 15% of liquid foods can be wasted due to inefficient packaging. So what they're doing is it's modified two natural products. All right, now look, it says now there's a separate team of engineers, mostly come from Colorado State University, but they devised their own solution to sticky containers. And it's a material that's fabricated with FDA-approved edible material using a low-cost, scalable, single-step process. Now, that's what they're calling it. FDA-approved does not, it doesn't impress me. I don't believe, you know, no. Wow, they approved it. Whoopity-do, they approve a lot of stuff that's not good for you folks. But it says that they modified two natural products. They modified carnauba wax and beeswax. And then they put them, they subjected them, they says, to a spraying process that imparted a micro texture. And then with this micro texture, of course, they put these coatings on. And it says, you know, they start showing in this the video and stuff of them using some stuff. So basically what they're going to be doing is they've come up with some crap that's probably going to make you sick. Probably going to shorten your lifespan if you start doing all of it. It's only a matter of time till it's approved and every company starts using it. So if you're going to get honey, you might want to make sure the honey that you get, it doesn't come all the way out of the bottle. You got to crack in there and dab it out of there, something like that. But anyway, they're going to be putting carnauba wax and beeswax on the inside of your bottles, folks, in a real light spray so they just slide right out. That's what's going to happen now.
That sounds amazing.
Yeah, right? Sounds like so much fun.
What have you got planned for your week?
As little as possible, I hope, but that's not the way it's going to work out. I'm going to be dealing with the state again, coming up here before long, another week or so, and that's about it. I'm doing putting some more work. We're doing another one of the videos, so hopefully I'll have that video out, let's say about maybe this coming weekend. I'm going to try to have all the finishing touches put on it, and this weekend have episode 2 of Unusual Encounters popped out.
That sounds awesome. Don't forget, people, if you'd like to share your experiences and stories with us, you can send them to expandedperspectives@yahoo.com, or you can call the show 817-945-3828. And if you'd like to send a specific story for Unusual Encounters, don't forget to put that in all bold in the subject line. Cam, stay out of trouble, my friend. I've got a busy week, and we'll talk to you elite members on Thursday. For Pretty Lights, Inner Tradition Books, New Page Books, Warwick & Associates, Llewellyn Books, and Ancient American Magazine, I'm Kyle Filson. He's Cam Hale.
Stay out of trouble, y'all. Peace.